Hey everybody, how's it going? Welcome back to another exciting episode of Cooking with Skorch. So today we're going to be making chicken tetrazzini, which is a baked Italian pasta dish that's got a cream-based, butter-based sauce. Baked in the oven, it contains chicken, spaghetti, mushrooms, and cheese. That's pretty much it. It's not a whole lot of complication to this one. Takes about half an hour in the oven. The only prep time you got to have is you got to cook some chicken. Since the recipe calls for cooked chicken, I'm going to start off with raw chicken here. You can buy cooked chicken or already prepared chicken in like cans if you don't have the time or the effort to to actually make it. I'm going to start with some raw stuff here, so I'm going to go ahead and cube those up, and then we're just going to fry them in a frying pan. That's usually the way I do it. Depending on what your method is, you can cook it whole and then cut it up, or you can cut it up first and then cook it. It doesn't really make a difference. It just depends on how you like your chicken when you're done with it. It's a relatively easy dish. Like I said, it's cream and butter based, so the ingredients are going to be relatively simple. We're going to have a quarter cup of butter, which is about half a stick for those of you that buy it in this form. We have 1 cup of heavy whipping cream. So because this is very high in fat, if those of you that are not prone to wanting to have heavy cream-based sauces, you can actually use a thinner substance like 2% milk or a thinner cream, and you can thicken it up with a little bit more flour because you want to keep the consistency right. So this is going to call for a quarter cup of flour, as the recipe says. This right here is your thickening agent, and it's going to go into what makes the sauce a little bit, I'm going to say grainy a little bit. You kind of know what I mean if you have these kind of baked dishes that have white cheese or white sauce. You kind of get that, it's a texture sort of thing. So the flour is going to help do that. It's going to call for about 1 cup of chicken broth. This can is probably about 1.5 cups, maybe 2 cups, so I'm going to measure out whatever I need for this. The recipe also calls for a 4.5 ounce can of mushrooms. I happen to like mushrooms, so I'm actually going to use 2 of these. Since they're not very big, you're not going to have to worry about running out of space or running out of filler or whatever. So not too bad. Your topping is going to be grated Parmesan cheese. So this is the fresh stuff that actually goes in the refrigeration case. I find that this actually tastes a little better when you bake it in dishes. You can use the stuff that comes in it's already grated in the plastic jar or whatever that is. That stuff doesn't actually require refrigeration, and it's just a different kind of taste, so whatever your preference is. And the pasta that actually goes in this one is going to be just plain old spaghetti, so I got a whole bunch of it here. It calls for about 7 ounces of uncooked pasta, so I took the spaghetti and I kind of just broke it up into thirds and I stuck it in this bowl here. So it's about, 3 inches long or so. I just broke up about 7 ounces of this. You boil water and cook it like normal. And then what you're going to do is you're going to drain it, set it aside, and while kind of that's happening, you're going to prepare your sauce. So then when everything is ready to go, you're going to mix it all together, and then you're going to bake it in the oven for about 1/2 hour at 350. So it should be relatively quick. It's not too much difficult, not a lot of prep time. A lot of these meals, a lot of people try to shy away from them because of how much time it actually takes to prepare them. So I like to stick with things that don't take a whole lot of time to prepare. But because we have to actually cook our chicken, it's a little bit longer. It's probably going to be another 15 minutes or so above and beyond what we actually need to prepare this thing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to cut the chicken and prepare it, be ready for putting it in the frying pan, and I'll show you guys all those steps, everything necessary. So I'm going to go ahead and do that, and then when we come back, we'll be preparing our ingredients. So stay tuned. I hope you enjoy. All right, so we're going to start by taking the chicken, and we're going to cut it up into cubes. So this right here is about 1.5 pounds of raw chicken breast. I bought this one actually pre-packaged, but you can find them in better cuts, ones that don't have some of the rib meat and stuff on them. For the most part, this is pretty well trimmed, so I'm just going to go ahead and make sure that I got all the fat that wasn't trimmed off, cut off of this here. Because you don't want your fat to be baking into your dish, because then it'll disrupt the consistency and it's probably not good for you. Usually you tend to find it more towards the center of the bird. You can tell what the fat looks like because it's going to be this kind of white color, not the color of the meat itself. You don't have to go crazy trying to prepare that or anything like that, but you just want to be aware. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to cut these into cubes like this. This piece actually is a little big, so what I might do is actually fillet this one and get it into two thinner pieces that are actually easier to deal with. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to go grab a knife for that real quick and I'll be right back. Okay, so we got a fillet knife here, so because you don't want it to be too thick, otherwise you'll get too much juice and it'll make the chicken tough. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take it's a sharp knife, usually used for like filleting fish, something like that. We're going to take the knife, we're going to insert it into the center, like so, and then just work it through from end to end while keeping your hand pressed on the top, so that way the knife doesn't fly out and you can keep it level, so that way you don't end up cutting through the bottom of the chicken. So I'm just going to do this until I come out the other side. And it doesn't have to be perfect, you just want something that's a little bit more manageable. So this right here, I've got a thinner piece now and I can actually do a little bit more with that. And it also kind of exposed some of the stuff on the bottom that may not be something that you want to eat. Depending on the cut of your chicken. This one's actually not too bad. There's no bones in it or anything like that, so we don't have to worry about finding that. So I'm just going to finish cutting this up here. It doesn't have to be perfect. You just need to get it into kind of bite-sized pieces. It's going to be whatever you're comfortable actually eating when you get the thing baked. Now, since raw chicken is very slippery, you want to be really careful when you're using a knife to cut because it's really easy to slip and you don't want to get your fingers caught. My cutting method may not be the best for most professionals out there, but I've got a head on my shoulders. Just use common sense, make sure you're safe, and you shouldn't run into any issues. It also helps if the meat is like partially frozen because it doesn't slide around as much, so you actually get a little bit more control over it. But basically once you kind of get it into strips, you just crisscross yourself and you can get cubed relatively quickly and easily. So they'll look, I don't know, probably about that size when you're done. There's a little bit of a trail on there, but that's fine. So I'm going to finish cutting these chicken breasts and we'll probably actually do everything over at the stove for the remainder of the video, since there's not really a whole lot of preparation to be done other than gathering all your ingredients. So most of it's just going to be adding stuff to the pot and making sure that we stir it well enough. So I'm going to finish cutting these and I will see you there in a bit. Okay, so we're back and we're at the stove now. So I'm going to grab the chicken that I just basically cut up here into cubes. And I got a frying pan on the stove and I turned it on to about medium heat or so, and I've actually got some olive oil that I'm just going to put in the bottom here so that way we can add a little flavor and keep a little moisture in the chicken. We're going to let that heat up for a little bit and then I'm just going to throw all those in there. And then pretty much what you're going to want to do is you're just going to want to make sure it's cooked all the way through. So anytime you're cooking chicken or any type of meat, you want to make sure that not only are you cooking it to the right temperature, but you just want to watch the color. So since these aren't whole pieces, cooking it to the right temperature is not going to be as easy to check, but it's going to be a little easier to make sure that you've cooked it all the way through. And that just basically means that we're going to be looking for the color that it is now, where it's kind of like a pink color. We're going to want it to be white. So pretty much what we're going to do is just throw that in there. It's going to take about 10 or 15 minutes or so, depending on how powerful your stove is and what type of cookware you're using. If you use like a stainless steel cookware, you just want to watch out for it being able to stick. But stainless steel cookware tends to heat up faster and it distributes the heat easier, so people find that it's actually easier to cook with that. I've got a mixture here of things that we're going to be doing with stainless steel and non-stick, but more on that later. In the meantime, you can probably hear that I've got some water boiling. This is going to be for the spaghetti, so I'm just going to put that in there and cook it for about 10 or 12 minutes. That's usually about how long it takes spaghetti to cook all the way through. And also, again, depending on your taste, if you like it more tender, less tender, al dente, as they say, the times will vary. And also, like I said, if you decided to change up your pasta, with any of these pasta dishes, you can really take liberties for what type of pasta you really want to use. So you'll just have to adjust your cooking time accordingly. And then once the chicken is ready to go, what I'm going to do is come back and we'll show the making of the sauce in the saucepan. So hopefully you guys will be able to see that well. I'm short on actually being able to get the camera up high enough to actually look over into things on the stove. So I'll do what I can to make sure to tip it up so you can see it, you know, that type of stuff. So now that this is warm enough, I'm just going to throw all that in there and we'll use a wooden spoon to just keep watch on it. So I'll come back when it's time for the sauce. So I'll see you guys in a bit. Okay, so now we're almost ready to actually start the sauce now. So you can probably see, I'm gonna tilt this up here so you can see it, but the chicken is pretty much done. There's still probably a little bit longer that it can go, but actually I'm not too worried about it. It's been sitting in a hot pan and it'll actually bake in the oven and actually finish. So you don't have to be totally crazy on getting it well done, but you'll notice that there's probably, there's a lot of juice still in there. You can probably see that towards the bottom there. You just wanna make sure that when you scoop that into the sauce at the end, that that's either drained out or you just scoop it out without capturing the juice, because otherwise it'll thin up the sauce and you don't want that. So I'm just gonna move this to the back here and sort of set that aside. And the pasta now, if you can see that, is it's a little on the firm side, which I actually happen to like, so I'm just gonna take this off the water now and then throw that into a strainer in the sink, and then I'm gonna move this saucepan forward and we'll go ahead and get started. Okay, so to start here, what we're gonna do is take an empty saucepan. We're gonna start with the butter. So anytime you're doing anything with butter or cream or anything in heat, you got to make sure that you're actually paying attention to the temperature and how much time it's been on there sitting idly. So you want to make sure that you're stirring it, because cream and butter and any of those things will burn really easily to the bottom of the pan. So I'm gonna do my best to show you what's going on, but still kind of keep an eye on this thing. So we're gonna start with a low heat, and I'm just gonna take this and we're gonna throw that into the bottom there. And since this butter is already pretty soft, it's going to not take very long to actually melt. So what we're going to want to do is melt this to the bottom here. Since this burner was actually already on, that's why it started so quickly. We're just going to make sure that we stir this. I've got a wire whisk here that I'm going to use to kind of get that all melted in. You want to make sure that this doesn't burn, because not only will it be not useful, but it'll smell and it'll make the food taste bad. So you don't want that. So once this is all melted, one of the ingredients that I didn't have shown at the beginning was salt and pepper. So I've got some salt and pepper here. I'm going to use fresh ground. It calls for about a quarter teaspoon of salt and about a half a teaspoon of pepper. I usually eyeball it when I mix things in like that, but if you want to measure it, go right ahead. It doesn't make a difference. So once this is all ready to go, the butter's almost melted. You can kind of see that at the bottom there. So once that's all melted in, like so, we're going to add in the flour, the quarter cup of flour, and the salt and pepper. So I'm going to start with this. I'm just going to go ahead and twist this a few times to get that mixed in there. Salt, the same, and then the flour. And we're pretty much going to stir this until it's nice and thick and bubbly. Now the issue with using a whisk to do all this is the fact that sometimes it's hard to get the edges of the pan. So if you need to use a spatula or a spoon, you can do that as well. You just want to do this to keep it from sticking to the bottom and to make sure that it's mixed well. So you can kind of see that it's sort of, there's not a whole lot in there, but we're going to be adding in a bunch of liquid in a minute here. So now what we've got is the mixture that we need to add the cream and the chicken broth to. So I'm going to open this can of broth here. Make sure we're ready to use it. So what I'm going to do is stir in the cream Just gonna pour that in there. And now once you've got to this point, you kinda gotta be ready and committed, because otherwise you're gonna get to a point where it's not gonna be any good to you because it's just gonna burn to the bottom. So we wanna stir that in. And you're gonna bring it up to a boil. So this stuff, like I said, since it cooks really fast, so once you turn it on high, it won't take long for it to actually get to a boiling point. So you wanna make sure to always keep it stirred. I'm gonna measure out cups worth of chicken broth, which is a little more than half the can. It's about a 14, 15 ounce can. Gonna pour that in there. We're just gonna stir this and bring it to a boil. So right now it's just kind of like a mess, just a white mess. So what we're gonna do is bring this to a boil. We're gonna stir it constantly for about a minute, and then once it's done, we'll be ready to add the one of the ingredients that I didn't mention was 2 cups of water. So I have 2 cups of water here, or if you prefer a little bit more flavor, you can use like a dry cooking wine, like a sherry or something like that. I didn't have any on hand, so I just went ahead with water. Once this is boiled and we've stirred it, we'll reduce the heat. We'll add in the chicken, the spaghetti, the mushrooms, and the water. And we'll mix it all together and then add it to a baking dish. Ungreased baking dish, about 2 quarts in size. We'll top it with cheese and then we'll bake it. So this hasn't quite brought to a boil yet, so I'll probably cut some of these boring parts out so that you can see these steps when they actually happen. You just want to make sure that you're always stirring it so that it doesn't get burned to the bottom, otherwise it's not going to be any good to you. Okay, so I'm going to tilt this a little bit for you here. You can see that it's sort of already starting to get hot on the bottom. It's starting to boil. We're about that point now where we just have to let this go for about a minute or so, stirring it constantly. You should be noticing at this point that your mixture is getting thicker. That's a sign that what you're doing is correct. Partially that's due to the fact that you've got flour in there. So flour and liquid, when it heats up, it becomes a thickening agent, which is also helpful for repairing recipes that you've messed up or maybe overestimated on the amount of liquid. Flour is very helpful when it comes to thickening up your sauces. And knowing how to use it properly is a very helpful tip in the kitchen. So this looks a little thicker now. I'm gonna move that a little closer so you can see it on the light. Unfortunately, the overhead light here doesn't stretch very far, so I apologize if you have trouble seeing that. Like I said, we should stir this for about a minute or so, and then we're gonna take it off the heat, and we're going to add in those ingredients. So I'm gonna move this over here. And then I'm going to prepare all that stuff. Okay, so now we've got the sauce here, and I grabbed myself a spoon because it's going to be easier to stir this stuff. The sauce is pretty thick, and I got the chicken that I took from the frying pan. I just got it in this bowl here, so I'm going to add this first. I'm just going to dump that right in there. The recipe calls for about 2 cups of cooked chicken. I probably have more, but I tend to like more meat in most of my dishes, so I will always stretch the recipe to add more protein, both from personal preference and because it's good for you. So let's add that. You can kind of stir as you go, because otherwise it'll become a little bit more tough to mix everything up. So that's looking real good here. You can see that. Okay, so we got the chicken all mixed in there nice, and now it's time to add the water. So I made a gross error when it came to describing how much water or liquid you have to put in this thing. It's not 2 cups, it's 2 tablespoons. And it's a very, very large error to make, but it happened. So don't put 2 cups of water in here, otherwise you'll be doing that flour thing that I mentioned. So I caught it in time. But yeah, don't fuck that up. So I'm gonna put the water in. I'm gonna stir this around some more. It'll probably thin it up a little bit, so you might have to take some liberties with how much liquid you actually add. Stir that up well. Smells good already though. now I'm gonna add in the mushrooms. Gonna dump the can of those in there. As I said in the beginning, I was gonna have two cans. I'm gonna add the other one. Mix that in well. And then last but not least, we'll have the pasta. Now, at this point, you can actually take some liberties with what you're actually mixing in here. So if you wanna mix in some cheese, rather than just have it on the top, you're more than welcome to do that if you happen to like a lot of cheese in your baked dishes. I do, but I'm not gonna add it into the mixture here. But if you wanna do that, you know, feel free to do that. It's not gonna mess up the recipe. And then we'll just sorta, since they're all stuck together here, I'm gonna do this in bits. Gotta make sure you mix it in well. Like I said, if the pan gets too full, then it'll be hard to stir, so. And also, if your spaghetti or pasta is sticking together a lot, you can use olive oil when you actually boil it and then put it in the strainer. Olive oil keeps it from sticking together. And it may also add some taste to it, so it's up to you if you really want to do that or not. Generally, it's not too uncooperative. So right now, this actually looks kind of like something that you would see just like maybe a child or something just throw a bunch of ingredients together. You know, sometimes some of those meals that you used to eat when you were a kid were just a bunch of stuff all mixed together and you couldn't get enough of it, but then when you turn into an adult, you're like, what the hell is that? That's gross. There may be a little too much pasta here, so maybe we don't want to mix it all in there, but we'll see. You want to have some sauce left over, but again, too much sauce sitting at the bottom, it'll just burn and it won't be as tasty. I think we've actually got enough here to probably use the last of this. This is pretty much, since it's all the ingredients, I may as well just throw it in. So just jam it on in there, stir and get it covered up. Don't worry about breaking it up. It doesn't really have to retain its original length from what it started at. You can see here we're sort of running out of room. It's a good thing. Picked a big enough saucepan. That's another thing too, is you want to make sure you pick a big enough saucepan, otherwise you're liable to run out of room and then having to compensate for it later is sort of a pain in the ass. So I'm gonna pull the baking dish in here and then we'll add that to the baking dish and put it in the oven. Alright, so let's just pour this thing in here. Big pile. Make sure to get all the stuff out of the pan. Doing my best to make sure that I'm not blocking the view so you can see it. Just empty that pan out. Should be nice and thick. That'll make for a good bake. And sort of spread it out evenly here. And then last but not least, you want to top with cheese. So this right here will just be a liberal sprinkling of cheese on the top. And again, you're not limited to like Parmesan cheese, which is what this is here. You can use any sort of grated cheese. Asiago is a really good one. Romano, depending on if you like the flavor. Mozzarella might even be one for you. It's not really one that I would probably pick for this dish, but to each their own. That's what recipes are meant to be for. They're meant to be experimented with. So you know, you do what you cook for your audience, I've always said. Now, we're ready to put this in the oven. So I'm gonna grab the lid here. I'm gonna cover that up and we're gonna stick it in. We're gonna bake for about 30 minutes and that should be it. So hopefully that was an experience for you. So we'll come back when this thing is done. We'll have a final look and see how it tastes. All right, so it's been about a half an hour and at 350, and here's our finished product. It looks great. So this actually is one that I, like I said, I don't make very often, but it's one that has enough of the ingredients that I actually tend to enjoy. So hopefully this is gonna taste really good. It's one that didn't take very long. And it makes quite a bit. There's about 6 servings here, so depending on how big your audience is, you adjust the recipe accordingly. So if you're, you know, only eating for 1 or 2, maybe you don't make as much, or maybe you've got a horde of, you know, 6 or 8 people, you want to make a little bit more. But it goes a long way, and it pairs well with just about anything. So I hope you guys enjoy it, and like I said, you know, let me know what you think. If you enjoyed the recipe or have any suggestions or things that you might want to try on your own, I'm always open to hearing suggestions from the fans. As I always say, don't be afraid to let me know what your thoughts are in the comments below. And as always, follow me on Facebook and Twitter for any updates on my channel and various things that I'm up to. And you can keep up to speed on the things that I've got planned for the future. So, as always, don't be afraid to contact me, and I'll do my best to respond. So I hope you all enjoyed this chicken tetrazzini recipe, and I will see you for my next episode. Take care. Later.